Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. In my ongoing series of talks on guru issues which face the Vaishnav world, especially the ISKCON world at the present time, and it's not just at the present time, but yeah, it's a look at guru issues, especially in relation to ISKCON at the present time. It's most appropriate to consider, we've considered so many things, but who is the guru of the Hare Krishna movement? Well, if we say the guru, then Krishna, Krishnam Vande Jagat Guru, but the Hare Krishna movement has spread all over the world by the grace of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as manifest in the personality of His Divine Grace Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. So just to put all our guru issues in perspective, as we try to follow in the footsteps of His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada, very difficult footsteps to follow in some ways not so difficult, because Srila Prabhupada said, just do as I am doing. In some ways, difficult to follow. Sometimes Srila Prabhupada said, it's not very difficult to be a guru. You just repeat the words of Bhagavad Gita, but we're finding there are difficulties. So anyway, at this point, it's appropriate to speak on the significance of Srila Prabhupada. I'm going to show a PowerPoint presentation compiled by His Holiness Badri Narayan Swami, who kindly sent this to me and granted his permission to use this. To speak on the significance of Srila Prabhupada, who can do that? Who can understand the glories of Srila Prabhupada? Still, as a disciple, it is my duty and my pleasure to try to do so. And of course, there are so many disciples and they're all glorifying Srila Prabhupada. And this, again, this PowerPoint was put together by Badri Narayan Maharaj and some perspectives that he came up with. Basic points of the significance, the contributions of His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada. One thing all the followers of Srila Prabhupada agree on, I don't think there's anything that all the followers of Srila Prabhupada, at least those who have been around for some time, I don't think there are any two who agree on all issues. There are so many issues and so many controversies as we try to bring the pristine Vedic culture and the pinnacle of that Vedic culture, pure devotion to Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. There's so many divisive issues and the editing of Srila Prabhupada's books and the post-samadhi Ritvik guru issue, and then who is the successor of Srila Prabhupada, and the guru voting system, as it's called, and then the rape purport in the fourth canto, and now we have devotees divided, vaccination, pro-vaccination versus anti-vaccination, but all agree that Srila Prabhupada is the founder Acharya of ISKCON, is the great pure devotee who was empowered by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to bring Krishna consciousness to the West. All those who call themselves followers of Srila Prabhupada agree on that. Whether they're Ritvikvadi or non-Ritvikvadi, whether they're highly critical of the ISKCON gurus or not, they all agree that we should recognize the insuperable contributions of Srila Prabhupada and do what he says. So, let's get on with it. Nirvishesha Shunyavadi. Srila Prabhupada enshrined in his own pranam mantra, which he himself composed because his disciples at that time were so ignorant of even the basics of Vedic culture that there was no one who could compose a pranam mantra for him. But it might not have occurred to his disciples what he saw as his main contribution, and that was his main contribution. How can it mean? He gave, Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He gave the Hare Krishna mantra. He gave prasadam. He gave deity worship. But this point, let's say, this point he stressed on, and it's the same point that he praised his own Guru Maharaj. Absolute is sentient, thou hast proved. Impersonal calamity thou hast removed. This point Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur very much appreciated. So Srila Prabhupada took that as his mission also, delivering the Western countries, Paschatya Desha Tarne. We may say, well, how are the Western countries filled with impersonalism and voidism? We don't, Buddhism is not so strong, and Advaita Vedanta is not so strong. Well, Srila Prabhupada was dealing with hippies mostly, and they were very much into all these things, reading books like the Tibetan Book of the Dead and Hermann Hesse's Siddhartha and Alan Watts' book on Zen Buddhism and all these impersonalistic things. Apart from that, the Western civilization is founded on Christianity, but at the present time, the predominant creed, which most Christians have kowtowed to, is the idea that impersonal forces govern the universe. Of course, the Christians will say there's God in control, ultimately, but they accept the scientific method, man is the measure of all things, and that there are impersonal random forces govern the universe. That's an underlying presumption of scientism. I won't get into that too much now because there's so much to say. But Srila Prabhupada stressed this so much. And actually, if Srila Prabhupada hadn't gone to the West, and this is a point which I don't feel is fully appreciated or even thought about very much, no one would have known the distinction between the representation of Hinduism that everything, ultimately everything is meant for merging into one. We used to see in the dictionaries that Hinduism, or what is the definition of Hinduism? And they'd only give the idea, the impersonal idea, that all Hindus believe that ultimately we all have to merge into the oneness and become God. But people wouldn't have known the difference. They wouldn't have known there was anything else if Srila Prabhupada hadn't come to the West, preached, distributed books, and established the actual Vedic message, Vedaisya Sarvaraham Eva Veda. I, Krishna says, am the goal of the Vedas. Vedanta Krit, I am the maker of the Vedanta. The message is Krishna, the person. So Srila Prabhupada stressed this very strongly. Is the goal just to come to zero? You'll find all the gurus in the West before Srila Prabhupada came. This idea of merging into a state of, well, that's Buddhism especially, to zeroness, and the Advaita Vedanta, often referred to arrogantly simply as Vedanta, as if there was nothing else to Vedanta but the Advaita interpretation of it. But the idea is very similar to the Shunyavadi of Buddhism. is that you merge into a oneness. So Srila Prabhupada saved us from all of this. What is the goal of meditation? And this is some cartoon someone made with, it's a bit sacrilegious, a parody of the Buddha meditating on chocolate, which is also, of course, a great anachronism. But anyway, it's a cartoon and they do things like that. But Srila Prabhupada, he would say like that because meditation was very popular in the West at the time. Nowadays, meditation has become very popular in the West as a means of stress relief more than anything. But Srila Prabhupada found among the hippies so-called meditating and so-called transcendental meditation, $35 to get a mantra at the time. It was some idea of spiritual meditation, but Srila Prabhupada said, I have seen yogis meditating. They're snoring. They go to sleep. They become so stress-free that they fall asleep. And, in some Buddhist schools, they have that, right? The all the rows of monks meditating, and they have to keep it straight back. And if they go down a little bit and they start to fall asleep, whack, they get whacked with a bamboo. So they're not allowed to fall asleep. Srila Prabhupada is very merciful and gave us a very joyful process. His disciples also tended to fall asleep during Bhagavatam class. It doesn't happen that much nowadays because we don't have many Bhagavatam classes. But Srila Prabhupada didn't reject them or beat them with a bamboo for falling asleep. So another thing is meditating on sense gratification. It's not so easy. This meditation process is not easy, as Srila Prabhupada often pointed out in his early lectures. We'll find those early lectures are transposed into The Perfection of Yoga, that book, and Krishna Consciousness, the Topmost Yoga System. So Srila Prabhupada stressed very strongly, there is an absolute reality, and the absolute reality is Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is beautiful, plays on a flute, is surrounded by beautiful women. Lakshmi Sahasra Shata Sambrahma Sevyamanam. Srila Prabhupada would quote verses from Brahma Sanghita. He used to know them all by heart, establishing Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Reality the beautiful. So these are all general points, you can say, of that any guru will teach, or any Gauriya Vaishnav guru will teach, but the fact is that it was Srila Prabhupada who taught it and brought it to the world. He wasn't the first Gauriya Vaishnav preacher in the West, but he was the first one to be effective on a massive scale and actually establish Gauriya Vaishnavism in the West. We have fallen into a dark well. Well, that's a well. That's a photo of a well. It's hard to get a photo of a dark well. There's not a dark well. It's quite a visible well, still in use. You can see by the bucket. It's not an abandoned well, as most wells, or at least in India, are nowadays, because technology. But it'd be hard to get a photo of a dark well because you wouldn't recognize it. That's the whole thing. It's a hole in the ground. You still get like that in agricultural fields. They're just like a hole in the ground. But if it's abandoned and then it becomes overgrown with grass, and then you wouldn't even notice it. And then you fall into it. And how will you get out? How will you get out? You have to yell and scream, and then someone merciful may come and help you by throwing a rope. So if we're calling out for the mercy of Guru, or calling out for the mercy of Krishna, Krishna, please help me. And then Krishna sends a Guru, and he throws down the rope of transcendental knowledge and how to come up. But we have to take the rope and climb up. It's a big topic. Fool number one and fool number two. This would be funny if it wasn't for the fact that This would be funny if it wasn't for the fact that someone clearly crashed. This isn't, well, maybe it's a photo job. I don't know. Maybe it is. But anyway, we hope that someone didn't crash and kill. Actually, if you look at it a little carefully, it looks like it very well. I think it's a photo job. Yeah, I think it is, actually. But anyway, the idea is that someone gives you bad advice. Learn to fly here. It's not a creditable school. And someone else follows the bad advice and gets killed in their effort to fly high. So in the same way, someone may say, oh, go to that guru. He's very good. And you go and you think you're going high, but the ultimate result is that you crash spiritually. Srila Prabhupada pointed out also, who's a real guru? Who's bogus? Don't go to bogus teachers. We're grateful to Srila Prabhupada for all these gifts. We may say we believe, but what is it based on? And Srila Prabhupada gave this story. He told the story of Sagaral Singh. So the news was going around the town. Sagaral Singh has died. And the tradition in India, which people don't follow much nowadays, is when someone dies who's close to you, especially if they're a blood relation, but it may be someone who's just, if they're dear to you, that you shave your head and go into mourning as a, yeah, it's a sign of mourning. In different cultures around the world, there are different signs of mourning or rituals to be followed. So what happened, there was one man, he'd shaved his head, and he was greatly distressed. And someone saw him and said, oh, what happened? Someone died. He said, Sagaral Singh died. And the man, he told, was so much affected by this that he thought, well, I should also shave my head and go into mourning, because obviously it's a cause of great grief. And so what happened, then someone else saw the second man who was mourning, and it went around and around the town and eventually came to the chief man in the town. He saw so many people, they've closed their businesses and they're mourning, they're looking depressed, they've shaved their heads. He said, what's going on? He said, I don't know, Sagaral Singh has died. Sagaral Singh has died. And the chief man asked, well, who is Sagaral Singh? I said, well, actually, I don't know. Who told you so? Who told you Sagaral Singh has died? Well, and then the man that the leader of the town asked directed to another man, and this way they trace back to the original man. Who is Sagaral Singh? No one could say. And the original man said, oh, Sagaral Singh, Sagaral Singh. I had a donkey called Sagaral Singh, who I love very much, and he died. Oh. So you may believe something and you may feel it very deeply, but it may be complete nonsense. Separating truth from reality, separating reality from truth for the welfare of others. Our real position in this world, this is just going through a quick and somewhat humorous look at many of the basic teachings that Srila Prabhupada taught us. Guru teaches. So here we have a golf ball who's sitting on a golf tee thinking, life is wonderful. I'm sitting very comfortably here. He doesn't know he's about to be forcefully thrown out of that position and put somewhere else far away. So that's our position. We're in the material world, we're thinking, yeah, everything's very nice. We don't know that very soon we're going to be thrown out of our position and completely beyond our control, we're going to be placed in another place. We're going to die and go to another body. That is our position in this world. Continuing. Yes, therefore, an intelligent person, as Srila Prabhupada taught in 1966, you will hear this series of lectures Srila Prabhupada gave on Chaitanya Charitamrita in New York. He gave a series of lectures. First of all, he told the story of how Sanatana Goswami came to the lotus feet of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And then the questions that Sanatana Goswami very humbly asked to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as an ideal disciple. This is how we should approach a guru. Ke ami kene amai jare tapatrai. Who am I? Why am I suffering? Once Srila Prabhupada asked his disciple, a group of disciples, who needs a guru? And devotees said, well, everyone needs a guru. Prabhupada said, no. Someone who wants to know how to come out of the suffering of this material world, such a person needs a guru. And of course, Srila Prabhupada's reply was based on the Bhagavatam conclusion, the Upanishad conclusion, that tasmad gurum prapadyeta jignyasu shreya uttamam. Therefore, one should surrender to a guru and inquire about the highest and ultimate benefit. Therefore, in this context means having understood that everything in this material world is a cause of pain. Then, another point, we have to go through guru because you cannot take the kingdom of God by storm. It's not such an easy, you just can't march into the kingdom of God. Even in this material world, it's an unusual thing for the demons even to be able to come to the heavenly planets. It's possible, but it doesn't happen often. We can't even go to the heavenly planets simply by our bravado. There's a system to go there, to what to speak of going to the spiritual world. Don't take God and don't take liberation as such an easy thing. All these things we learn from Srila Prabhupada. How can the finite understand the infinite? We are tiny little beings on a tiny little planet in a tiny blip in time. We don't know that we are, in one sense, part of Mahavishnu's dream. Millions of universes emanate from the pores of his body when he breathes out. And he is Kala Vishesha. He's simply a part of a part. He's non-different from Krishna, but in another sense, he's a part of a part of Krishna. So we're so small and God is so great. We can learn by descending knowledge, which Krishna very kindly gave playing his flute. The sound of the Gayatri Mantra entered the eight ears of Lord Brahma, who passed this knowledge down. The system we have to learn through a parampara, a sampradaya, which goes back to the original source. It's not that a guru is self-made. The example handed down from branch to branch, you can't see probably, but if you look closely at this photo, you'll see that it is a photo of a mango tree. And Srila Prabhupada gave this example. It actually has green or unripe mangoes on it. But when the mangoes are ripe, how to get the mangoes from the tree down to the ground without spoiling the mangoes? You could just shake the tree. As Bhaktivinoda Thakur gives the example. Najai brikopari. Na jai brikopare Dala Dhari Tane Tane. Dushta Fal Koribe Arjun. I don't exactly remember, but if you don't go up the tree, if you don't go up and you simply shake the tree, then you'll spoil the fruits. So someone has to go up, find the proper fruit, pass it down to someone on the next branch, who pass it down to someone on the next branch, hand by hand it's handed down. So this is the system. In our Brahma Sampradaya, we come through Brahma. Krishna hoite chatur mukha, hoi Krishna shevan mukha. And there are four Vaishnava lines. Sampradaya vihina ye mantra ste nishpala te mata. A mantra, even if you get a proper mantra, if it's not received in the proper Sampradaya, Vaishnava Sampradaya, it will become, for our purposes, useless. So the four Vaishnava lines are those from Brahma, Shiva, the four Kumaras, and Lakshmi. What happened in this Kali Yuga, that the Vedic knowledge was rejected by Lord Buddha, superficially rejected. By Lord Buddha to stop the misuse of the Vedas. Nindasi yagya vidher ahaha shruti jatam sadaya hridaya darshita pashu ghatam keshava dhrita buddha sharira jaya jagadisha hare. Being very merciful upon the animals who are being slaughtered in the name of Vedic sacrifices, Lord Buddha rejected the Vedas, but the result was Vedna Mania Bodh Hoilo Nastik. The followers of Lord Buddha became outside the Vedic fold, they became atheists. So, what he taught, renounce this world of suffering, nirvana. So, the actual meaning of nirvana is very good. We have in Bhagavad Gita, Brahma Nirvana Richati. But he pointed to ceasing to exist. Actually, it's very difficult to put it in words because according to Buddhism, we don't exist anyway. But there's some idea of ceasing to exist, although we don't exist. Anyway, Shunyavad. Shunyavad is one particular school of Buddhism, but in general, the idea is this ceasing to exist, voidness. Shankaracharya taught very much the same thing, but he, of course, the followers of Shankara wouldn't agree with that. But the ultimate goal is to lose one's identity. So in that way, it's very similar to Buddhism. So therefore, the Shastra says that prachandam bodham uchyate, what Shankara taught is covered Buddhism. But he did establish the Vedas as being authoritative, and that there is transcendental permanent reality that is Brahman. But then he taught that Brahman is nirguna, which without any qualities, which is stated in Shastra. But of course, that should be understood as not having any material quality. So this is a representation of Shankara, and we have in the picture also Dwarakadish, Jagannath, Subhadra and Baladev in Puri. So this the four mutts that Shankara set up in four directions of India, at Dwaraka in the west, at Puri in the east, at Rameshwaram with the Shiva Linga in the bottom right corner in the south, and at Badrik Ashram in the north. So in the bottom left, we have Badri Narayan deity. Then Ramanuja, he was the first of the Vaishnava Acharyas, in this Kali Yuga. Before him, there were the Alavars of the Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya. The last of them, Sri Yamuna Acharya, started to expound in writing the philosophy of the what came to be known as the Sri Vaishnav Sampradaya. But this work was taken up in great detail by Ramanujacharya, who preached widely. So he's the first Vaishnava Acharya. And in this Kali Yuga, chronologically speaking, and he opposed Shankara's ideas, but he rejected the Kevaladvaita of Shankara and propounded the Vishishtadvaita, that in one sense everything is one, as Shastra says, but it's a qualified oneness. It's not only oneness. Anyway, 2 points are given here, that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu accepted 2 points from each of the sampradayas. Ramanuja in Sri Sampradaya, coming from Lakshmi. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, of course, Srila Prabhupada comes in the line of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu accepted from Ramanuja's teachings the concept of pure devotional service free from the contaminations of karma following and jnana. Karma means following the Vedic literatures for the sake of getting material enjoyment, and jnana in this context means following the Vedic path with the idea of merging into the oneness of Brahman. So Ramanuja rejected that, and he also gave great importance to service to the Vaishnavas. All these points are there in all the Vaishnava Sampradayas, but very much stressed in the Ramanuja Sampradaya, and of course in the Gaudiya Sampradaya also. Next, chronologically, seems to be Madhvacharya. And in terms of the philosophical developments in history of Vedanta, these three acharyas are always considered by scholars most important. Shankara and Ramanuja and Madhva, they presented their philosophies in response to Shankara and in rejection of Shankara. And these three traditions, Shankara, Ramanuja, and Madhva, they have produced generations of scholars up to the present day who are deeply versed in the intricacies of Vedanta and Vedanta dialectics and polemics. So these two Vaishnava acharyas, Ramanuja and Madhva, are considered very important. Madhva comes in the line from Brahma, known as the Brahma Sampradaya. Brahma to Narad, Narad to Vyasa, as related in the Bhagavatam, and at a much later point in time, Vyasa to Madhva. Madhva went to see Vyasa, who is a Chiranjeevi. He's a long living, he's still living in the region of Badarik Ashrama, and if someone's as exalted as Madhvacharya, they can go and speak to him at the present time also, as Madhva did. So 2 points that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu accepted from Madhvacharya is something that all Vaishnava Sampradayas accept, that we're eternally individuals even in liberation. But in particular, the strong rebuttal to Mayavad, very, very strong rebuttal by Madhva and his followers of the Kevaladvaitavad of Shankara. Very, very strong. You can see there Madhva with Hanuman and Bhim. He is the Vayu avatar, the strong wind, who came a strong Hanuman to fight the demons, strong Bhima to fight the demons, and strong Madhva to fight the demons of impersonalism. And also, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu accepted from Madhva's teachings service, the concept of service to the deity, accepting the deity, the supreme personality of Godhead, to be Satchidananda, eternal, not to be anything material. Now we're going to have to cancel this, okay. Then, Vishnu Swami, his sampradaya coming from Shiva, revived at this same time as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu by Vallabhacharya and going on at the present time. Main place is Nathdwara. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu accepted from Vishnu Swami the teaching of exclusive dependence on Krishna, Goptritve Varanang Tata, and the concept of spontaneous devotion beyond the rules and regulations of the Vedas. This is a central point of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's teachings, to come to the platform of spontaneous devotion, the Raga Marg of the followers of Sri Radha and Nanda Yashoda and Subal Sudama in Vrindavan. So that's also taken from and developed to the maximum in the Gaurīya Sampradaya. Nimbarkacharya, also very, his teachings very similar to Gaurīya's, taking shelter of Srimati Radharani and great respect for the gopis' love for Krishna. So our Gaurīya Acharya is commentating on Nimbarkacharya. It's more or less the same idea, but they're not fully developed as the Gaurīya's have given them. So this is just showing how the Sampradaya comes down very quickly. It all culminates in the Achintya Bheda Bheda Tattva, inconceivable simultaneous oneness and difference, taught by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who passed it on to the six Goswamis, who in their writings laid the foundation for the Gaurīya Sampradaya, Sri Rup Sanatan, Bhatta Raghunath, Sri Jeev Gopala Bhatta, Dasa Raghunath. Particularly we're known as Rupanugas, because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's inner feelings, which he came to give to the world, were revealed by Rupa Goswami, as we find in Chaitanya Charitamrita. And he also gave the core literature for Gauriyas to follow. Everything is summed up in his Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, which was translated and presented by Srila Prabhupada as the nectar of devotion. Rup Sanatan, these are the two most senior of the six Goswamis that portrayed here. Then the line of previous acharyas. This is supposed to show Rupa Goswami. I'm not sure exactly who that's supposed to be, but anyway, there's a line which comes down to Jagannath Das Babaji, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, the great, great figures, Gaurkishore Das Babaji, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. We see here pictorial representation that's painted by Bhaktisiddhanta Prabhu, a disciple of Srila Prabhupada, at the time, Abhay Charan Dei, being given Harinam initiation in Allahabad at Rupa Gaurīya Math by Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur in 1933. And Srila Prabhupada delivered the same timeless message perfectly according to the current audience. As Srila Prabhupada would often say, it's the same message that he is delivering, the same message that was given by his own Guru Maharaj, which was given by Gaurkishore Das Babaji Maharaj, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, Jagannath Das Babaji, Baladev Vidyabhushan, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, Krishnadas Kavi, Narottam, I left it in, Narottam Krishnadas Kaviraj, Swarup Damodar, Six Goswamis, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, all the way back to Lord Brahma and ultimately Krishna. It's the same message. Srila Prabhupada gave the message perfectly, according to the current audience, considering it was a very, very different audience to any that any of the previous acharyas had given to previous acharyas had operated in the land of dharma. Srila Prabhupada also gave this example that there may be many medicines in the shop, but the prescription is given by the doctor according to the patient, his condition. So in the same way, Srila Prabhupada presented Krishna consciousness, the same message according to time, place, and circumstance. He gave the same message. Srila Prabhupada predicted Lochandas, contemporary of Lord Chaitanya, or just after. So Lochandas, he cites Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as referring to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's own Senapati Bhakta. Senapati means a military general, so who will establish Krishna consciousness very widely. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's teaching, Priti Vite Ache Jato Nagaradigram Sabatsapracha Haibe Moranam, was fulfilled by Srila Prabhupada, that Krishna consciousness will be spread all over the world. This is a photo of Srila Prabhupada on the roof of his quarters in Bombay, Juhu. Srila Prabhupada was predicted by Bhaktivinoda Thakur predicted that soon there will, all the devotees of the world will come to Mayapur and chant, and one great devotee will go out all over the world, Bhaktisthan Saraswati Thakur. It's a great history. He also recognized that Srila Prabhupada will do everything in due course of time. He recognized Srila Prabhupada as the great personality who would fulfill his own mission. Empowered, Krishna Shakti Bina Nahe Ta Pravartan. Kali Kale Juga Dharma Nama Shankitan, Krishna Shakti Bina Nahe Ta Pravartan. In Kali Yuga, the Yuga Dharma, the Yuga, the religion for the age is the chanting of the holy names. Without being empowered by Krishna, no one can spread Krishna consciousness. Srila Prabhupada came to America with 40 rupees of non-exchangeable currency, so he was practically having no money. Came with nothing, no friends, one contact in some insignificant country town. Within 13 years, he had established Krishna consciousness all over the world. 108 temples at that time, now it's many more. He installed deities all over the world. Rathiatras on every continent, it's written here, except Antarctica. But some devotees have been to Antarctica and distributed Srila Prabhupada's books in the meantime. Thousands of disciples, Mahamaya Mataji made the effort, she in particular, and managed to find the names of about 4,800 disciples of Srila Prabhupada. But there are more, because he initiated, before he came to the West, he had initiated several, although only one is known. Millions of books distributed, millions. Even in 1 year, devotees were distributed, in Srila Prabhupada's presence, devotees were distributing literally millions in plural, and that's going on. Mystic power. You may wonder, what's this about? What's all this about? Apple here, and then there's the photo of the entrance to ISKCON Vrindavan. What's all this? Did someone turn an apple into a temple? Or what happened? There's a story told by Badri Narayan Maharaj, and I don't recall anyone else saying it, but anyway, here goes. I'm not saying it's not true. There are so many stories of Srila Prabhupada, but Badri Narayan Maharaj tells the story of one time when Srila Prabhupada was in his room in Calcutta, which you can still visit. Tarun Kanti Ghosh came in. Tarun Kanti Ghosh was a colorful figure. He was a really extrovert kind of character. I remember seeing him once. He was a big man in West Bengal. He was in the, I believe he was a minister in the state government in the last, I believe that was the last Congress government. And they, well, of course, now Trinamool Congress is in, but the last Congress, anyway, the last Congress government in West Bengal. He was the proprietor of a group of newspaper, Amrita Bazar Patrika, I believe, Jugantor, two of the most famous Bengali daily newspapers. I believe it was his great-grandfather, who was Mahatma, as he's called, Shishir Kumar Ghosh, who was a friend of Bhaktivinoda Thakur's, who founded the Amrit Bazar Patrika newspaper, and who was a friend of Bhaktivinoda Thakur's, although Bhaktivinoda Thakur could never convince him to stop eating fish. Anyway, Tarun Kanti Ghosh was a big man in Bengal at the time, big man in politics and in Bengali life in general. And he came in to Prabhupada's room very excited, telling Srila Prabhupada that he'd seen a yogi who out of nothing had produced an apple. And it wasn't a trick. He did it in such a way that it was could be seen. He just manifested an apple. There was no apple, he manifested an apple. And Srila Prabhupada explained to him, yeah, okay. All right, out of nothing he manifested an apple. Well, out of nothing, I manifested so many devotees all over the world, so many temples. So who has got more mystic power? In Hyderabad, this must have been 1975 or 1976, in a big public program, someone asked Srila Prabhupada that can he show miracles? Because the ludicrous Sai Baba was very big at the time, especially in Andhra Pradesh, of which at the time Hyderabad was the state capital. And he was famous for making miracles, doing things like producing, not apples, gold watches and all kinds of things out of nothing. Maybe out of his sleeve, but anyway, he fooled many people. So Srila Prabhupada gestured towards his Western disciples and said, these are my miracles. Another time, in Vrindavan, I believe it was, a magician came to see Srila Prabhupada and he did all kinds of tricks. And when it was over, he did a little magic show for Srila Prabhupada and his disciples, right in front of Srila Prabhupada. And Srila Prabhupada said that, okay, you can do good magic, but can you stop birth and death? Can you do that? And the magician said, no. Prabhupada said, I can do that. So Srila Prabhupada's mystic power. Srila Prabhupada was sitting for many years, writing his books, meditating on the order of his Guru Maharaj, Radha Damodar Temple, looking out at the Bhajan Kutir of Rupa Goswami while he took prasad. That was Rupa Goswami's Bhajan Kutir. It looks different now because it's been developed. And Srila Prabhupada revealed that Rupa Goswami personally came to him and ordered him or gave him blessings for going to the West. Srila Prabhupada is brave. Once Srila Prabhupada, while walking in the morning in Calcutta with some of his disciples, they were walking on the Maidan in Calcutta. Those who know Calcutta know there's the Maidan at the side of Chaurangi. And there in that Maidan, on one side is the Victoria Memorial. So Srila Prabhupada said that when he was a child, he had climbed up the scaffolding to the top, which is pretty brave for a little kid to do, to climb up the scaffolding to the top. And Brahmananda was there and said, he said, Prabhupada, you must have been very brave. And Prabhupada said, yes, I'm still brave. Otherwise, how could I have come to the West? It's actually incredible. Such courage to come alone. Krishna was with him, but it was really a mission impossible. And his compassion, once in San Francisco, 1967, he was giving a talk, and then a young woman, intoxicated, must have been LSD or some psychotropic drug, started yelling at Prabhupada. Very gross way. You don't deal with sadhus like that. Even if someone's not a sadhu, you don't yell at an old man. It's just speaking incoherent nonsense. And Prabhupada, almost under his breath, said, it is the darkest of darkness. But Srila Prabhupada went on. That was his compassion. This is a photo, famous photo of Srila Prabhupada translating at the Henry Street Temple, how he got this dictaphone, which was cutting-edge technology at the time, and how Garga Muni got the dictaphone for Prabhupada. He was very excited. He wanted to show Prabhupada how it works. Prabhupada knew. It was new technology, but it seems like it's an eternal part of Srila Prabhupada's leela to translate like this. A very good comment given here by Badrinarayan Maharaj. The rivers of the previous Acharya's commentaries flowing into the sea of Srila Prabhupada's purports. Srila Prabhupada said once that by reading my books, you get in contact with the previous Acharyas, because it's the distilled essence of, in his books, is the distilled essence of all the Acharyas taught. Ah, this is showing the chain. It's like a chain of disciplic succession. From the powerhouse, electricity can be generated to a huge long distance, but it requires a continuous chain or a continuous line. So this is represented here in this photo, how the powerhouse of Krishna, the power is sent and can be sent over a long distance in time and space, analogously, but the chain has to be unbroken. The founder Acharya holds a special position. Actually, Srila Prabhupada's position as founder Acharya of ISKCON is somewhat unique. It's not exactly the same as being what we call the Sampradaya Acharyas. We have Ramanuja, Madhva, Vishnu Swami, and then again we have Vallabha Acharya, who re-established the Vishnu Swami line, and Nimbaditya, Nimbarka. It's not exactly the same. We have Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, can be said to be the founder Acharya of the Gaurya line, although, it's a complex thing. It's not that complex. Rupa Goswami, we follow him. So Srila Prabhupada, he's the founder Acharya of ISKCON, which is an empowered branch from the trunk of the Brahma Madhva Gaurya Sampradaya. That's right. You can see in that photo, there's a big branch coming off from a peepal tree. So, what does it mean, Srila Prabhupada, to be the founder Acharya of ISKCON? He's the Shiksha Guru for all ISKCON devotees, including ISKCON gurus. Yes, we all study Srila Prabhupada's books, which he said will be the law books for the next 10,000 years. We all worship Srila Prabhupada daily. His instructions are essential teachings for all ISKCON devotees. Yes, his books. We read his books. His emphasis, mood, standards, and practices shall remain the measure for ISKCON in perpetuity. Yeah. In this regard, I want to say something because it may not be exactly the same. There may be some tweaking here and there. No major changes, but there may be some little change. Just like Srila Prabhupada introduced, I'm just giving a small example here. 4:30 in the morning, Mangal Arati. But I know at Chaupati ISKCON, at least it used to be 5 o'clock in the morning, with the idea that, well, more congregational devotees can come if it's a little later. And also Bombay being so far west in India, the sun rises very late there. So it's in terms of the sun rising, it's like 4:30 in Calcutta or more so. So a little thing like that. 4:30 to 5 o'clock, of course, you don't want to move it to 7 o'clock. But there may be some little changes here and there. It may not be exactly the same, but his emphasis, mood, standards, and practices shall remain the measure for ISKCON in perpetuity. Srila Prabhupada's humility personified. Trunadapi sunechena is the famous verse, which is the standard of Vaishnavism. Just some examples when... in one airport, Srila Prabhupada was sitting, waiting for his flight, and all his disciples were gathered around him. These were the days before security checks. So the disciples were gathered around Srila Prabhupada, and there were so many of them, they were blocking the path so people couldn't get to their flights very easily. And an airport official saw Rupanuga Prabhu, who had this bhav of being a leader. He was very definitely a leader, and he had this mood. So an airport official came to Rupanuga Prabhu and said, could you ask your people to leave the terminal because they're blocking the passengers from easily going to their flights. So Rupanuga got up on a chair and said, all devotees should leave the terminal immediately. And devotees didn't want to leave, but guess who got up to leave? Prabhupada. Humility. One time, Srila Prabhupada was, a devotee had to put a painting on it, just above the seat where Srila Prabhupada sat. And in doing so, the devotee had to step on Srila Prabhupada's seat, which a disciple shouldn't do. And when the devotee asked Srila Prabhupada, was it all right? And Prabhupada said, yeah, for service you can do. For service you can stand on my head. Another time, Srila Prabhupada, another instance of Srila Prabhupada's humility. One time in London, Trivikram Maharaj was massaging Srila Prabhupada, and Trivikram Maharaj explained that I felt like, because the night before Srila Prabhupada had been at some big public program and he'd been very strong and there'd been some oppositional comments from the audience, and Prabhupada had shot them down verbally. And so Prabhupada, Trivikram Maharaj, was massaging him, and he felt, he recounted that, I felt like I was a trainer massaging a prize boxer, so I had to, he felt I should encourage Prabhupada so he could feel more enlivened to God and fight more. And he was saying, Prabhupada, you're so great, you're doing such strong preaching. And he went on like this, and the Prabhupada said, no, I'm simply a servant. There are so many examples of Prabhupada's humility. One is given here by Badrinarayan Maharaj at some in Los Angeles, stunned in ecstasy. It happened several times. He became stunned in ecstasy, thinking of Krishna. Yet he could be a lion, or very strong on the point of you must follow your guru, but it was another act of his kindness and concern, knowing very well that we don't know what we need to do. Srila Prabhupada is very strong on emphasizing, you just do what I say, knowing that we, Westerners especially, we don't have the culture of obeying a guru, and wild minds. The example given here is of a night landing for a plane. So this shows the landing lights at an airport. So you may be a good pilot, but even to be a good pilot, you have to be trained by competent pilots. And to land a plane, of course, nowadays there are hands-off landings, computer-guided landings. But the path to land on is cut out. You just don't land anywhere in the airport, on the field, here and there. The specific landing strip that is allocated to your plane, you have to land on that. You have to land at the right point, and the lights are there to show you the way. So it's all very fixed, but you have to take guidance in order to land the plane properly. So this is just an example that's given, that you have to be trained as a pilot, and then even to come to the final destination, you have to be guided and you have to follow. So Srila Prabhupada stressed this very strongly. We have to follow the instructions of the guru, who is himself. About his position as the founder Acharya of ISKCON, there are many examples. Here, sign on the Detroit temple. This means Srila Prabhupada, one time he arrived at the ISKCON Detroit temple at the time. And now that's another whole Prabhupada Leela, how the present temple was acquired. This was around 75. When he got out of the car, he saw the sign on the building saying ISKCON and Hare Krishna, but it wasn't written Founder Acharya A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami. And before doing anything else, he just arrived, before doing anything else, he called the temple president, which was Govardhan Prabhu. And he quite strongly corrected him that you should have my name. That's stipulated. And then Govardhan immediately had a devotee paint the sign. So Srila Prabhupada pointed that out. He wanted his name, wherever there's a sign saying International Society for Krishna Consciousness, Srila Prabhupada wanted it to be written, Founder Acharya, His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. And he wanted it on all letterhead of ISKCON, on flyers and posters. He wanted to stress that very strongly. Even when his godbrothers, some of them were very unhappy that he had taken the title Prabhupada. But Prabhupada said, I didn't accept it myself, but my disciples give that title to me. But when he was once discussing with Tamal Krishna Maharaj, and this point came up, Srila Prabhupada said that, if anyone challenges you that why am I, your guru, called Prabhupada, he said to them, you ask them, how much preaching have you done? How many countries have you visited? How many people have you brought to Krishna consciousness? How many temples have you opened? How many books have you written? So in this way, Srila Prabhupada, he wanted to establish his position for our benefit. Read Prabhupada's books, listen to his lectures, worship him daily in Guru Puja, be connected with Prabhupada. He is the founder Acharya of ISKCON, means He is there for all generations. Here's another point. Even though we're in the Gaudiya Sampradaya, which is aimed at Ujvala Rasam Swabhakti Shriyam, the highest bliss of the Radha and Krishna's love, we have to be very careful in approaching this. And Srila Prabhupada warned us about this. And you may wonder, what is a picture of a goat doing there? What's that got to do with Radha Krishna Lila? I thought it was cows, right? It's gopis, not goatees. Goatee means a little beard. And that's the story. Srila Prabhupada told a story once about a sadhu who was all giving a public lecture talking about Radha, Radha, Radha. And he saw among the listeners, there was a woman who every time he said Radha, she would, she's very emotional. So after the talk was over, he spoke to that woman and said, oh, you really appreciated my lecture. You must be a great devotee of Radha, because every time I say Radha, you become overcome and start crying. She said, yeah, yeah, you know, I used to have a goat called Radha, and you're talking about Radha, but I was so attached to that goat. And you know, Sadhuji, you have this long beard, and when you shake your head, it reminds me of my dear pet goat who had a little goatee, a little beard. And so I'm feeling... So Srila Prabhupada used this as an example of imitative ecstasy. Srila Prabhupada came to give us the ecstasy of the spiritual world, but he warned us, don't imitate. Krishna's Kaviraj Goswami, the author of Chaitanya Charitamrita, interestingly, his Chaitanya Charitamrita is accepted by all orthodox Gauriyas as the final word, the ultimate canonical exposition of the position of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his pastimes. There's even a book written by a professor from Chicago University, Tony Stewart, called The Final Word, in which he analyzes how Krishnadas Kaviraj's Chaitanya Charitamrita superseded, not exactly superseded, but put in context all the previous works on Chaitanya Charitamrita and all other works on Chaitanya Mahaprabhu which follow after that have to follow the conclusion of Chaitanya Charitamrita. So it's the final word. It's the ultimate canonical literature for all Gauriyas on Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. But the point here is that Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami didn't personally ever see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He writes in his book that he got information from the karichas, the notebooks of Murari Gupta and Swarup Damodar. And of course, he also heard from Raghunath Das Goswami, pastimes of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And in this way, he composed Chaitanya Charitamrita. So what's the point in relation to Prabhupada? Well, that will be explained more in the next point, that there are those who want to say, I'm directly a disciple of Srila Prabhupada, even though they never saw him. But that's not required to understand him or to get his full mercy. Or rather, as Srila Prabhupada said in relation to his own guru, that the grandfather is more merciful than the father. So there's no need to concoct any Ritvik philosophy or any such thing. The chain goes on. You can be connected to Srila Prabhupada, but not by any artificial method. This is the mystery of the Sampradaya. As Srila Prabhupada states in his purport to Bhagavad Gita, chapter 18, text 75, the spectacles are there to show that one has the power to see, but if one has the right spectacles, one's power to see is more clear. And in this regard, I'm going to read Bhagavad Gita, chapter 18, text 75. Vyasa prasadat chutavan etat guhyam aham param yogam yogeshwarat krishnat sakshat katayata swayam. Srila Prabhupada's translation, by the mercy of Vyas, this is Sanjay speaking to Dhritarashtra at the end of Bhagavad Gita, by the mercy of Vyas, I have heard these most confidential talks directly from the master of all mysticism, Krishna, who is speaking personally to Arjuna. Extract from Srila Prabhupada's purport to this verse. One has to understand Krishna not directly, but through the medium of the spiritual master. The spiritual master is the transparent medium, although it is true that the experience is still direct. This is the mystery of the disciplic succession. So, not understanding Krishna directly, but through the medium of the spiritual master, the experience is direct. The knowledge is given through the medium of the spiritual master, but the experience of Krishna consciousness, which is awakened from receiving that knowledge and put it into practice, that is direct. So we have a direct relationship with Krishna, but that is through the medium of the spiritual master. This is an eternal principle. And Srila Prabhupada is the founder Acharya of ISKCON and the Shiksha Guru of all those in ISKCON. But still, we have to go through the Sampradaya. I have created your good fortune, Srila Prabhupada said to a meeting of Tamil presidents on the West Coast. Go and create fortune for others. Give the light in the age of Kali, the Srimad Bhagavatam Puranako Dhunoditaha, the sun in the Kali Yuga, the sun has arisen. There we have Vyasadev showing the light of the Srimad Bhagavatam, a takeoff of Moses and the Ten Commandments in a famous film from the 1950s, I believe it is. Give the light of the Srimad Bhagavatam as given by Srila Prabhupada. ISKCON's founder, Acharya. Hare Krishna, Srila Prabhupada ki jai. So there we have it. In just over an hour, trying to squeeze the infinite into just over an hour's discussion. All glories to His Divine Grace, Srila Prabhupada, whose glories are infinite, and who we as tiny finite souls worship. And by His mercy, we can be introduced to the infinite, infinitely loving Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna. Vancha kalpa tarubhyas charkipa sindubhya ivacha patita anam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha. Dante nithaya churnakang padayane patya kritva chakakushata metada hambravimi he sadhava sakala eva vihaya durat Gauranga Chandra Charane Kurutanuragaha. Parivadatu Jano Yata Tata Va Nanu Mokorona Vayang Vichara Yamaha. Hari Rasa Madira Madati Mata Bhuvi Vilutama Nartama Nirvishama. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Sri Vishnu Sahara.